Well.
Hello, Eamon. How are you?
How are you doing? Where's this bus going?
Well, we just went to Leo's Tavern, so we think we might go somewhere different.
Do you have much in Leo's Tavern?
Hi. We had 97 women from this city who attended, so we had a good time.
Good time.
All right, dears?
Yes.
So, what we... what we are very much hoping is that the way we think this will work is I'll ask Catherine a few poignant leading questions and she'll talk a little, but we very much want you to be involved then. So we would invite your questions. And you know the way sometimes an event like this will happen and somebody like me will say this and then it never actually happens and you get to ask questions or get offer feedback. So we very much invite you to do that today. And I think Catherine and I will chat amiably for maybe 20 minutes. And then we want, you know, we would welcome your questions, your feedback, your observations. That work, yeah?
Okay, yeah.
So one of the Catherine, this is my pleasure, yeah? One of the things that I know is that you were born this side of the river. And I'm not sure that, maybe people do know that here, but maybe you could say about growing up in Windmill Terrace, what you remember of that, and what happened subsequently that led you to be living in Tully Alley. Just a wee bit of your story.
My history. I don't really remember living on this side of the river. Ah. As such, I don't have an awful lot of memories. I was born in Clarence Place, which is in the fountain. And we moved to Wimble Terrace, which is top of the Dark Lane. And my parents, during the start of the Troubles, was one of the families that moved from this side of the river to Chapel Road. Then we were politely asked to leave the city. Well, my father was.
When you say so politely asked, you mean?
We had 24 hours to get out or else. So we moved from the city to Antrim.
Yeah.
And my father got a job in Antrim and my mother got a brand new house. And she loved it because she had this brand spanking new house that nobody else had ever lived in. And my father hated it. He hated it. He wanted back to Derry. So we stayed there for a while and then he just didn't like it and they couldn't settle. So they began to think about moving back. And Dean Good was the dean in the cathedral. And he said, I can get you a house. There's a house in Killaloe beside the church where they need caretakers. So we moved from Antrim and we moved back to the city. And they lived there for 6 months. And it was an old wrecky house. And you see when you went up the stairs to your bed at night, the mice went up below me. But it had a big orchard.
Yeah.
And the rector.
So they would be church mice, actually.
Good Christian. even when you kneel down to pray at night, they kneel down along me. And the minister there was, he ended up being the Canon Anderson, but it was the Reverend Anderson. And he was like a minister, but he was also like a part-time farmer. And he had pigs and, you know, so it was a time when you can remember we had apple trees and there was sows having piglets and you were kind of mucking at it, you know.
And what age would you have been then, Catherine?
About six or seven, you know. Yeah. And then they got a house then in Tully Alley.
Yeah.
After about 6 months out in Killaloe. And they moved to Tully Alley. And it was on the sticks. Because I remember, like, my granny lived in the fountain and we used to go and they visit her and people on the fountain used to say, oh, there's a wee country man's in there, you know. Because the bus stopped at the hospital. There was no bus to Tully Alley in them days. James, you can back me up on this. You had a walk, you know, you get the bus to the hospital and you had a walk.
They wouldn't let you on with a wee bar anyway.
No.
or a piglet.
Or a piglet. And, you know, I was one of those kids, you know, when you go to the supermarket now with your ma and you're delighted whenever she fills the trolley. I used to hate going to Kelly's supermarket because I knew that by the time I walked down from the hospital down my arms was nearly touching my ankles, or so it felt, you know what I mean? So he used to say, "Ma, we don't need that. No, we don't need that." Mm. You know, so.
And so you moved into Tully Alley.
Hmm.
And I know if we fast forward a little, because, you know, we don't want to do the whole autobiography here. But
so what are you saying? I'm now 50?
No, no.
All right, sorry.
We haven't gone that far.
All right, okay.
You're living in Tully Alley. What would have been your sense as the troubles are taking hold here of the relationship between Tully Alley, the troubles, the city, Derry, Londonderry, your youngster? I think you're at Clondermot, right?
I went to Clondermot, uh-huh.
But you're originally at?
Living Vada Grammar.
Yeah.
We had a headmaster in our local primary school who was from Living Vada. So anybody that got their 11 plus, they wanted them to, he wanted them to go to Living Vada. So I ended up going to Living Vada Grammar because
mm-hmm.
I got my 11 plus and I hated it because nobody down there knew where Tully Alley was or Drumahoe was, and they kept talking about places like Drumcern, and I thought, where is that? Hadn't a clue. And I just hated it. And I felt like a fish out of water. And you had to wear like a regulation duffel coat, and you had to have a big bag with a hockey stick. You imagine walking through Tully Alley with a hockey stick and a bag, you know what I mean? Like you were bullied left, right and centre. So I left it after a year and a half. And I went to Clondermot. But the good thing about going to Living Vada Grammar was a mixed school.
Mm-hmm.
And my friend that I got friendly with was a girl called Serena Nealis from the city. And she was Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
So it was the first time that I learned that Catholics get days off school that we didn't. They go to Mass for
yeah.
holy days.
Yeah.
So when she went to Mass, I used to go on her. And I used to stay outside, just come out. You know what I mean? Like, school never checked. But that was my first kind of awakening that there was something else other than Church of Ireland people, you know.
And had you a sense as a teenager of
troubles?
What's happening in
totally.
The trouble?
Yeah. Tully Alley is an interface estate, and there was a lot of stoning of buses and a lot of barricades. And I remember my mother and father owned a shop in the 1974 Ulster worker strike. And they decided that they would keep a shop open for people in the community because it was the street, the whole place was barricaded off. And I remember these Scotchmen coming into the shop and telling her, close it, or we'll close it. So that, you know, so I remember, you know, I remember being an accordion band and you know, I'm going to say something that's, well, you know, when you're young and you're foolish and you think that troubles don't impact you, but they do. Because there was a Catholic family lived behind us, and I used to have to practice the accordion, as you do, because you have to practice a musical instrument. But my mother used to say to me, see, when you're practicing that, make sure all them windows is closed and you're not offending anybody. But of course, she was never always in the house, like when I was practicing. So I used to have my windows wide open, and I used to be blasting the sash out of my accordion. So, you know, there were things that I did, you know, that when you look back on now, at it, they the whole, you know. So you were indoctrined because of where you lived. So totally the troubles did have an impact.
Yeah. And I know that you then got a job with Desmond's when you left school.
I left school.
Decided to leave school early, got a job with Desmond's.
Well, I didn't actually start with Desmond's. I started with Welch's, but I progressed to Desmond's. And
oh, like that word, I progressed to Desmond's, yeah.
Well. I did. I worked in the shirt factory industry, and for me, that is the biggest community relations organisation that existed in this city.
Say more
and
about that,
in,
Catherine.
In Northern Ireland. Well, you know, you live in, you can be born in Craigan, and you can be born in Tully Alley, and you might never meet somebody from the other side, and you might think everybody's like you, but you see the day you leave school, and you go out to work, well then, there's maybe six other girls starting the same day along me, and they might not all be the same background as you, but they're as nervous as hell as what you are. And you know, so you've something in common. And for me, the factories was where you cut your teeth in community relations. I don't know if anybody else in the audience feels the same, but I felt that that was my biggest exposure to the other community was when I went to work.
And what do you you know, in terms of that exposure, Catherine, what do you think he learnt then at that young age?
Well, he learnt that you have a commonality with people, and that whether you're perceived to be green or perceived to be orange, hey, you were working for your pound. You had wains to rear, you had the same issues, housing issues. You know, there was more common and common than there was at the bite of us.
Yeah.
You know? But then there were big events during the Troubles that would have split.
What are you thinking of when you say that?
Well, you know, just tragedies. Tragedies that happened. Well, I wouldn't have been working now when the hunger strikes was on, but you know. but there were big issues, you know. Like, I remember one time coming down the stairs in the shirt factory, and the big tannoids, you know, would give out the news and played music all day, and they were saying that somebody had been murdered. And there's two guys working a machine at the bottom of the stairs. As I was coming down the stairs, one guy says to the other, God, I wonder, is it one of ours or one of theirs? And at the time, you paid no attention to it. You see, when you sit now and you reflect, you think, did we all think like that? You know? So.
Yeah. And I guess when you reflect like that, this is called, as you know,
the Garden of Reflection. Yeah.
Maybe there's a wee moment where we all reflect. Is that the way I was thinking? You know, I would acknowledge that's the way I was thinking, you know, back then. And now when I look back, I'm ashamed of myself.
It was like a silent, nearly acknowledgement of what was happening.
Yeah. You told me that as we were chatting yesterday about this moment that we're now in, you talked about then you're married with a young family living in Tully Alley, and there's a bomb, the bomb that actually took a neighbour's life. Could you speak a wee bit about that? Because this is a story, I know many stories about the Troubles, but I didn't really know this story till you told me a number of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was in England when this happened.
1987, December, there was a death on the street. One of the kind of the characters of the area had died, and he was being whipped. And but that same night, the BB Old Boys Football Club had a big rickety wheel over in the newly refurbished 3 Mile House. So nearly everybody that I knew was at the rickety wheel. So my husband's aunt was on babysitting for me, but my wee sister was staying in my house as well because she was quite young. And my father, he's a horsey man, and he was at a horse fair. And when he came back, he saw a few people acting suspiciously in the street. And he went to my door, and he said, Lily came to the door, and he said, is Ian in, who's my husband? And she said, no, he's not in. And he says, well, who's in the house? And she said, the Waynes are in, and Vicky. So he said, I want you to go upstairs, and I want you to get the kids and take them to the kitchen, and I don't want you to come out of the kitchen again. So my father left, and he went up the street to see if there was any men about. But at that stage, the first bomb had gone off down the street, and everybody came out to the door. Anybody that was in came out to the doors to see what had happened. And two doors from my house, there was a wee, now Tully Alley's 99.9% Protestant. Jared Doherty, a wee milkman who's a Catholic, he went to his front door to see what was happening, and the second bomb was under his feet, and it blew into bits. And this is in the mouth of Christmas. So that kind of blew the heart out of the whole area. And nobody's ever claimed responsibility for that attack. The attack was seemingly meant for security force families who live in the Milltown Crescent, but the bombs were planted in the Milltown View. And those families had to move out after that because they weren't safe. And and after that tragedy, the housing executive and the police got together, some of the mothers, and they set up like a wee group. Now, bearing in mind, there was no community centre there, there was no youth club there, there was no community spirit or no sense of community. So these mothers would have took away into the swimming pool or took them away a day here, a day there. And every Friday they went round the doors and they collected 50p. And they took names of the weans for... So I used to give them 50p, but they never given me weans. Because I just didn't know what they were at, you know? Because you can be quite suspicious of something that you don't know about. So anyway, about 3 or 4 months after that, a lady came to my door and she said, look, we've set up a committee and we know you can type, will you take our minutes? And as soon as we get somebody to take your place, you can go. Right?
Yeah. Leads exactly to this moment.
Right.
She's still
so
here.
Years
yeah,
later.
Yeah, yeah.
So I said, okay, I'll help you out. And they used to meet in our children's home. We had a children's home beside our estate and the committee used to meet in the home. And I couldn't understand what they were talking about. They were talking about community development and self-help. And I thought, what? That was like double Dutch to me. Mm. So I thought, I have to learn about this. So McGee were offering a course on community development. And I applied to go on it. And I was accepted right away. What I didn't realise was I was going to be the only Protestant on the course. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. I signed up for the course and I did it at McGee. And I'd opened my eyes. And it's led me to where I am today. But so out of some tragedy, I suppose, has come for me a whole new way. Because up to that point, if somebody had said to me, describe your identity, I would have said that I was white, Protestant. And if there was going to be United Ireland, I was going to first move to Scotland. And, you know, I was just so fixed in a position that I thought my identity will never change. This is who I am. And, you know, and the experiences that I have and the journey that I have travelled on since that moment in time makes me the person that I am today, which is totally different.
What would you say, Catherine? So there's, what do you say your identity is now? And you said there when you went on the course, it opened your eyes.
Well, it opened my eyes to a whole new way of thinking. And, you know, like when I went to McGee, people from my community would have said to me, what are you doing going to McGee? You're full of opinions. Yeah. And, you know, what, you see them as over the town? And this is their words, not my words. They get everything. Sure, our community gets nothing. You know, and you had to learn that, you know what? It doesn't come knocking on your door. You have to get up and you have to apply for it yourself. It just doesn't come to you. Because we were brought up to believe that you don't rock the boat or the hand that feeds you. That we're governed by a unionist government and you don't challenge it. So there was a lot to learn. Mm-hmm. And you know, like things like, don't join the Northwest Community Network, I was told. Because we need a network of our own on the water side. And then our politicians would have said, who gave you your mandate? Who are you speaking for? Nobody's elected you. Mm-hmm. So you had all those types of challenges going on. And I was pretty young, you know, but it was feisty. And when somebody tells me not to do something, then you kind of think, well, what's behind it? Mm. So it was quite difficult days.
I heard somebody murmuring there. And when you said you were feisty, I heard somebody going, we know. We know. So you're doing the course. I think the first time I met you, Catherine, you were then working for the Peace and Reconciliation Group on the corner just up here. But I also knew that you were deeply involved in a leadership role in the Tully Alley and in community development. Mm-hmm. And you'd spread the net further, I would guess, as well. Do you want to just say a little about how you got into the PRG and the work,
well,
sterling work you were doing in Tully Alley?
As I say, I was doing all these training courses and I was still working in the factory. And in the factory, you know, if you're out for an hour, you have to clock out and clock in again. So I was clocking out more times than I was clocking in because I was doing all these training courses. And the only people really that it was affecting was my own family because it was reducing the wages coming in every week. And the lady that I worked along with, I don't know if any of you know her, she's from the city. She's from Springtown, Anna Begley. Anna used to say to me, you know, you're wasted in here. She She said, you need to get out there. You need to, do something different for your life. And so the more training courses and the more things I did, I was beginning to think, well, maybe I am wasted. Maybe Anna's right. Maybe I should be looking. And I had a long time relationship with the Peace and Reconciliation Group because they used to do the butter and the meat from Europe, the butter mountains and the, and they used to bring it to Tully Island. We used to open the doors of the community house and give it out, and used to work on the late at night. And then they would always done holidays to Cork and stuff as well. And we would have got them Protestant families that they were looking for to take part in. So I had a pretty good relationship with Tanya and the PRG team. So they were looking for a project worker. So I applied for it. And I remember going up to Bishop Street.
For the interview.
The only person who was going was Anna. And I went up and I seen Big John McCourt coming out of the room. And I thought, well, he's part of the furniture. So he'll get the job. So do you ever go into an interview and as relaxed as you like, thinking, well, there's no hope, but I'll just go for it anyway. So it was that type of interview,
A bit like this.
A bit like this. and then I got a phone call at 3 o'clock that afternoon to say the job was mine if I wanted it.
Whoa. Round of applause. Yeah. It's your first job in community development.
And you see, for 6 months, when people relations. Said to me, what do you do? I was going, God, I don't know. Really? People used to meet your project worker.
Has it changed, Catherine?
No. every day's a school day. But it was. That's where I cut my teeth.
Yeah.
So.
And one of the things that Susan mentioned in her introduction of you, which I thought was really right, you've been involved in a lot of quiet but effective work in community, particularly in your own community, but reaching out to other communities. Do you want to say, of course, if by nature it's quiet, then you might not want to talk too much about it, but is there anything you can say on that effective, quiet work of peace building that you've been involved
in? It's important.
Yeah.
And sometimes it just pays to be in the right place at the right time. And I know Susan's referring to the stuff around the bands forum and the FLA. And just happened to be in the right place at the right time with the right connections. And planted the seeds.
So maybe, I suppose I might know what you mean, Susan, know what you mean, but there'll be people here who might wish more information about that.
Okay. The Londonderry Bands Forum is a forum that's set up for the marching bands that parade around the city. And being chair of Peace 3, you're in quite a privileged position that you're aware of things that's going on in the city. And we knew that the FLA was coming, and I was part of the Waterside Area Partnerships cultural strategy. And we had some engagement with Culturland. And there was a flippant remark made one day about, and the person made it probably didn't even realise the impact of the statement that he had made, but he said, wouldn't it be great if we could get loyalists, bands involved in the FLA? And jokingly said, maybe they could lead the FLA. So that planted the seed in my head, and my husband was in the bands forum, and Roslyn, who was the manager of Peace 3, there was a bit of money available, so we went and met with them, and we said, they're looking for some loyalist bands to get involved in this FLA. And the initial reaction was, no way, Jesus. We'd get lynched in our own communities, never mind anywhere else. Mm.
The reaction was no way.
That's it. And basically, I said to them, just thinking that positive publicity that this could have, and so they took about 2 months to think about it. And sure luck, we all know what happened. And there was bands down last year in Sligo. And I hopefully that relationship between the bands and the FLA will continue.
Mm. I think what Catherine's not saying, if you don't mind me interjecting, is also the negotiations started, but then within a wall band, we had the FLA protest
happening.
It's not put a very different spin, and there's a huge step back. But with Catherine and Rosalind in particular, they took a bit of time and encouraged it very gently and very quietly between both communities and said, let's keep making this happen. And it did, in a very end, it had a very massive impact.
Yeah, and continues to, Susan.
Down in no small way to Catherine's involvement, you know, which Catherine's very modest.
Susan, thank you for, I like that word, interjection. Thank you. It would be really remiss, I think, if we didn't mention the 10 years of work with Foyle Women's Information Network. It's almost like this is the work that has been, you've been driving for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And I know there are people here from the network who are delighted that you're getting to hear you today. So please say something about that work, and then maybe that's the time to throw it over to Marie to ask that question, or James Greer, who, as we know, is from Toy Alley, or whoever. So, and bring the audience in, as we promised them. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I worked in the community relations field for 7 years, and it was very intense, very intense. It was like, some weeks you're working 60 hours. Oh, and I'm sure you can relate to that. And I was feeling a wee bit burnt out. So the job came up on the Foyle Women's Information Network, which my mother had set up many years previous. And it was something that was always kind of in the background. And plus, I was really interested in women's issues and had delivered the woman and the politics stuff here in the city and whatever. So the job was advertised, and I went for it, and I got it. Because I thought, you know what, it's going to be easy. Working on the women's sector is going to be so easy from the community relations sector.
Why are women laughing here?
And you know something, there's more conflict in that sector than there is in any. But anyway, that's another story for another day. But so I joined the network, and again, like any job, when you go into it, you finish off projects that other people started. But the network, I believe, has grown from strength to strength. And it was set up to, the Derry City Council set the network up along with community activists. They realised and they recognised that women were doing great work in communities, but they were doing it in isolation. There was no joined up approach, or there was no sharing of information, sharing of resources, or getting together. So the network was set up to do, believe it or believe it not, 10 events a year. To bring women together 10 times in a year. So I think we do that, don't we?
Yeah.
And that was basically the remit of the network. And the network, as I say, has grown from strength to strength. We've gone from 1.5 staff to 3 staff. Last year we had 4 staff, but unfortunately due to funding, we're down to 3, but hopefully. And we do quite a lot of work. We do an older women's programme. We have our information, which I believe is second to none. The information that's sent out quite regularly, I believe it is one of the best networks there is going. And the girls that bring all that stuff together work really, really hard to make sure that you get up-to-date and regular information. As I say, we have an over 60s project. We have our Summer Splash program. As I alluded to in your interview, we had 97 women last.
And Leo's.
And Leo's Tavern last week. Yeah. And we have a bus trip arranged or planned for the 25th of June, and we have, it went out on Friday, and today's Wednesday, and we have 147 names on the register.
Three buses.
Now, and this is only what, how many days in? 3 days in. So it shows that there's a need for this type of work to go on, that there's a lot of social isolation. Even though there's a lot of groups, there's a lot of women who are individuals and who don't want to join a group. So our network gives them the opportunity to engage at even just in and out as they wish. You know, so I think it's an important link in the city, because women were the glue that kept the city together during the conflict, during the troubles, and at previous times, and we're going to drive it forward. All right, go ahead, sorry.
Just
we'll
one.
Stop.
You're okay, Catherine. One of the things that, you know, I'm reflecting back on what you were saying earlier about Anna Begley, is that the right name?
Yeah.
She's saying to you, you're wasted here, you could be doing so much more. And I was asking you yesterday, what is your core motivation for this work, the work of peace and reconciliation, the work in the Peace 3 partnership, the work with Foyle Women's Information Network? And I think maybe we'd finish off by you talking about what is that motivation? What drives you, and in particular, what is it you want to see in relation to women in this community and the Northern Ireland community and across the board?
Equality. What motivates me as well is that this is my city and I want to be part of it. I want to be part of every part of it. I don't want to be just a part of a part. Mm. So I feel that this city is like a patchwork quilt, and that the organisation that I have the privilege of working for joins all those patchwork quilt pieces together to make one quilt.
Lovely. Catherine.
Thank you.
One of the things that we had a deal here about what would be discussed and what would not be discussed, and Catherine says, I don't want you to mention the fact I had a stripper on my 50th birthday, so I'm not going to mention that.
Yeah.
Catherine Cooke, give her a big round of applause, please. And over to you now. I'm not sure how we're doing for time, but...
We're okay, we're fine. If anybody's got any questions...
Questions, or even if you want to make observations or responses, you know, there aren't a question. Yeah.
Well, I would just like to say, I never got involved in anything until I met a certain lady, which was Catherine's mum. And it was her starting me coming on the bus runs, and she said, oh, are you coming? And it's just the idea of it. It's funny in my own mouth. It's not. Mine is to say to me, you're be present friends. You know, because I've never done, I was never out to socialise like that.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm coming here, I think it's marvellous. Because even the place here, I think it's a great feeling about it.
Yeah.
You know, and I love going on the bus runs, as Catherine's done it. It's all different people, and we're all the same. I beg for a smoke and make more people enough out for a wee smoke. But you hear why laughing, you're out there. You know, and that's where I would hear, you know, things about their lives too, and yeah, their presence. You know. And I'd just like to say, I'm finishing this now. The last night Dave was up here, you had a wee soldier talking. And when I came out of this room, I didn't like that guy. I just didn't like him, but at the end of the talk, I liked him.
Yes.
And I really got a great feeling, because that day, my niece was shaking hands with Prince Charles, because her grandfather was shot on Bloody Sunday. And there was this fella here, so I sort of brought it together, but you know, is peace at last now, it's over. We've shook hands with Prince Charles. What more now can we do?
And I think one of my reactions to what you've said so beautifully is, I think this is the kind of work you wouldn't be saying this in this open forum, only for the contacts you've made, I'm guessing.
Oh, I know that.
Through Foyle Women.
I said this building makes me feel at home.
Yeah.
You know, probably because you're working up the stairs. Like.
Thank you.
Well, we're there anyway. What are we working on?
Well, I'm bus runs, you don't have time to work.
No.
Thank you. Is there any, that's a beautiful way to start. Any other responses, feedback, questions?
It's like the Women's Network. Well, we met Catherine through the Women in Politics, and we had some good laughs there as well.
We did, yeah.
But outside of that, when you go out with her, an ordinary company, you don't know what's going to be happening. Between Blackpool and everywhere else that we went to, Cork, and you know.
What does that mean to you, Kathleen, in your life?
Well, I mean, I wasn't here during the trouble, so I had no input for that.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that made me equally Protestant or Catholic.
Yeah.
You know, that way. So I didn't mind who I met.
Yeah.
You know, and as for going over to the 250th birthday parties, they were to behold as well.
Okay, so one of the things that's clear is the network may be about serious business, but
yeah.
There's crack,
there's
laughter, there's
it's
entertainment.
Serious laughter.
Yeah, serious laughter. I see three hands went up there. James hand went up, and there are four actually, Jennifer and Ursula. So maybe we go James first, and then to Ursula, then
you
back to Jennifer, and then to Maureen.
You went to Limavady Grammar.
Mm-hmm.
Out of this.
you learned something that I
know. You love and learn. You mentioned Drumcern, and people were asking you, did you know where Drumcern was? Maybe they didn't know where Drumcern was.
Oh, maybe.
That's why they were asking you.
Yeah, you never know.
Is that what you wanted to say?
No, not really. No. You know, what I wanted to say seriously was that coming from where you've come from, you know, and maybe I understand this more than most, and doing what you've done, you know, I would like you to talk about the challenges that you must have met in your own community. And I don't know if you want to talk about that, you know, but I feel that intensely, you know, that people that would see you and I as...
half a Jaffa.
That's as good. You know something. That's as good. That's as good. That's as good analogy as.
Yeah,
it?
I don't.
Right,
it provoked laughter, but I don't.
No,
I mean that seriously.
No, you're right on. You're right on.
Yeah, maybe Catherine would. That's a very powerful question. I think.
I don't think people see me.
I'm
as
not
that.
Putting you in a spot.
No, no,
there,
no.
You know.
Hey, I don't answer the one I answer, James,
right,
and I can turn it round.
Yeah.
But I don't
feisty.
Think people see me as half a Jaffa. I really don't, because I have never. I don't hide from my background or where I come from, you know, so I don't wear it on my sleeve either, and I don't ram it down anybody's throat, but I'm quite confident in my own culture, my own identity. So, you know, I really don't. In fact, I met a group of women on Saturday from a certain part of Belfast. They were from the Upper Ardoyne, who are facing challenges in their lives. And they couldn't articulate their argument to me. You know, I said, well, what is it you want? You know, and they really couldn't, you know, answer the question. And I said to them, you know, you're sitting waiting on people to give you answers. But, you know, you have the power within yourself. And, you know, there are a lot of people in a lot of situations on all sides who on no sides who have a lot of challenges. But I think you have to be strong in your own self. James, I faced many, particularly in the early days, from politicians and gatekeepers from my own community, who were all male. They were all male, steel and pale, and they're still there. But now they come and ask me advice, and they ask me, what are the issues that the community are facing? So that's, it's taken 30 years, but you know, you could have,
that throws maybe hope and sadness at the same time.
Well, you could have run away and bowed down to their way of working. You know what I mean? And you could have just stayed in the house and cleaned your windows.
Mm.
But I'd rather look at a dirty windows and have a good heart. Do you know that kind of way?
Exactly.
So, but there's loads of challenges and they're still there. Like, I remember doing the interface work during Drumcree, and a woman from my own community saying, who do you think you are? You should be on that road with us blocking it instead of trying to get us off it. You know, they couldn't see that you were there to try and stop people getting arrested and trying to keep, like, there are older people who live in the interface who fear for their safety whenever there's riots and stuff. But people are just so fired and caught up in that whole adrenaline that they say, you know, get on the road with us, you know, you're no better. No. So you've all those kind of things that you work through. But I think if people realise what you're doing is for their benefit, and it's not against anything or anybody, then they kind of are okay with it.
James, that's a thank you for that question, and again, thank you for the answer, Catherine. Ursula, have you got a question or an observation? Or?
Well, both. First of all, I just wanted to say that I think it's very inspirational listening to Catherine's journey, and I've known Catherine quite a long time through the Junction and all the things that go on in here, and her work has been fantastic. I just wanted to ask about the women's group. I mean, it sounds like, first of all, that you have a great time, but also that it's had a lot of impact on a lot of women. Do you see this as having an impact then on the younger generation? Does it kind of feed back into the families?
Well, I hope so. Yes, I think so. I think that when you hear something, you tend to take it back into your family. And I see women as change agents, because they're grannies and their mummies and their aunties. And sure, where best do you learn but at your granny's knee or your mummy's knee? Do you know that kind of way? So I do see women as change agents, and I do see that whenever they hear, you know, if they come here and they experience something, then they take it back and they share with the whole family. Does that answer your question? Thank you.
Thank you, Ursula, for the question. Jennifer.
Yeah, as you can tell by my accent, I'm a blowing. I'd like to thank Kath for a very interesting conversation, excellent. And I'd just like to talk about the women in my community where I come from. I come from South Yorkshire Mining Village. At the time of the miners' strike, the women of that community were seen as red flag-waving socialist arrogants because they all got to Moscow to get the money that the Russians had given to support the miners. And yet, they were the ones that started the soup kitchens so the kids could be fed. They were the ones that were going around and helping after the aftermath of the miners' strike. And they eventually became councillors, local councillors, a lot of them. Before that, they were just housewives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were working class like you, Kath, you know, and they,
mm-hmm.
but they stood up to the test and still serve the community today, what's left of it. What I like to is the observation that it comes down to women. Women are the ones that have got the sense to say enough's enough, not the politicians. And I say that because I am a socialist as well. And I would just like to say that all the women that get involved with their communities have to be commended, or whether they are, wherever they are.
Lovely, Jennifer.
Thank you.
And Maureen, I think you had a question.
Well, James practically asked the question that I was thinking of, to be quite honest with you.
Yeah.
Well, do you know me? I always say something.
Yeah.
I think, to be really honest about Catherine, says that everyone, I've heard it a few times in this room, they've all said she's modest. She's not. She's not a modest person. No, she's not. She just doesn't like talking about herself to certain groups of people. But she can talk to anybody about anything. Very, very well, as she knows. But what I find, and I have to say, I've been very lucky. I've worked with her over quite a number of years in different tonalities, we'll call it. And I think it's only fair for me to say is that every single woman who does meet and work with Catherine in any capacity, whether it's on a trip, you want to call it a wee day out, certainly not just a wee day out, Garrison, you're underestimating the power of those days out by calling it such. But there's also women too that she's meeting with and men at strategic levels. But by far and large, Catherine will never ever work from top down. It's always from bottom up. And it's about the grassroots. Always about the grassroots. So she's always got her finger in the pulse of any community. And I think that's quite important. When we talk about doing the different aspects of her work, every single person who meets her will walk away feeling that she's become their friend. And you can see that there's a blur there. It's not black and white. Because people are talking about going to her party, her birthday party, and that's women that she's met in the context of her work, and they become her friend. And I think that's what it is. Yes, it's communication, but it's very, very much down to trust. And without a doubt, and I know Beth has done so much work before you came along and while you were here,
mm-hmm.
but by far and large, I have found that, in my own observations, Catherine Cooke had the trust and the respect of a lot of women in the Waterside area and in the PEL community to trust her and come along over to the city side, as we call it, and give it a go and see what the other women were like. That's down to her. That's down to her communication that she belittles all the time by using slight language and all the rest, but that's where her strength is. That she's a very, very effective communicator. And you have to commend her for it. She's done a brilliant job.
Thank you, Mark. You should go on holiday and you're off.
I know, I'm first time back.
What's it like, Catherine, when you hear, and I could hear the passion with which Maureen was saying that, and the serious intent, she's determined to say this. When you hear that, do you bat it away, or do you let it in, or have you heard it all before?
You know, when we're doing capacity building training with women and assertiveness training, we always say accept a compliment, and it's very difficult. But thank you, Maureen.
So it's difficult, but
it is difficult.
Yeah.
It is difficult. Because we're always saying, oh, sure, sure.
Yeah.
So I'm paid to do your okay or whatever. It's like when somebody says to you, oh, your hair's lovely. Oh, sure, only washed it this morning. Or you have a nice top on you. Primark,
Primark. Yeah.
You know what I mean? We never say, thank you. So
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's lovely. It's a lovely tribute, Maureen. Lovely tribute. Albert, are you about to ask a question, or is it just?
Of course not.
Yeah.
But you are now.
Yeah. Hello there, Marie.
Hello, Emmy. I just want to say a wee thing. I know we're on here about the reflection and all, but a lot of people don't understand the healing that Catherine has passed on to a lot of people through your cross community work, north and south. All over Northern Ireland, even further face at Brussels and place. But I think it's just, whenever people are with Catherine, they're, you know, as I was saying, we're all in the one boat here.
Yeah.
There's no such thing as, it used to be them and us, we don't even use them words. You know, I think that's through all this reflection and healing and just being there for each other. Because, you know, there is no difference, you know. We're all in the same bills to pay and the same things to do. Through Catherine too, I think, you know, has brought a lot of people a great understanding of each other's cultures. You know, more some people maybe don't want to know about their cultures, but through anything we're doing with Catherine, you always got that clear. You know, you always knew. She's an angel.
You're an angel. Yeah. We're almost talking about Catherine as if she's not in the room. Yeah. You know, it's like a wee bit like a Quaker meeting when there's a death. So Catherine, there's another compliment to accept or bat back.
Thank you,
Marie. You're an angel. Yeah.
I was going to say, now, I don't know if the community development, but when I first came here, or the second time I came here, I think I was talking to one of those tables, and you came across as a very modest person, but I knew there was a wide depth of knowledge.
Yeah.
To myself, most people that have a lot of knowledge, they want to tell you the first class degrees, and they want to bum and blow. And that was the thing, it was to be used of modesty, and I still see it in you today. I think you're too modest.
Yeah. Thank you.
For the knowledge that you have. I don't want to be bum and blow. Because there's a depth of knowledge there that she doesn't. She keeps quiet.
Yeah.
But it's there to draw.
You know, Albert, you know, he was under pressure a minute, and then we went away from him, Marie came in, and then this woman here, he's back now with a question.
Just to provide a bit of balance of all of this love fest.
Hey, Albert, you're in danger of undermining. Yeah.
I was just wondering if Catherine, that you understood what Anna Bailey was actually trying to tell you at that time.
I wish you'd go ahead, give me a head piece.
Maybe you're spending too much time better here and the team's taking a hit.
That could be.
Maybe you better find a job somewhere else.
Yeah. Catherine, you know, this may appear wonderfully ad-libbed. Well, may not. But we talked yesterday morning. And Catherine, I know we're coming up on two now, or I'm sensing that. You talked about the time Desmond's sent you to Morocco.
Yeah.
And this story really touched me yesterday. But I think it's got a relevance maybe for us all, whether we're men or women, because it's about humanity. I wonder, would you tell that again?
Okay, it was quite a few years ago, it must be 17, 18, maybe 19 years ago. And I don't know if you all remember the Spotlight programme that was done about the stuff, Marks and Spencer's clothes being made offshore, and they talked about employing women employing girls and
child labour.
They also, when they were filming undercover out there, they came across labels that said made in the United Kingdom being sewed on clothes. And of course, those were Desmond's lines at that particular time. And at the same time, those similar garments were being made in factories in Clawdy and Swatter and Dungannon and areas like that. So the consequence for Desmond's was that they had to close down their lines in Morocco. That was their punishment, basically. And I was asked to go to Morocco for 4 weeks to make sure that the quality was kept to the highest level. I worked in the community. Yeah. I worked in the quality audit department in Drumahoe, and we had to ensure that there was no jobs lost here right up to the very end. And 4 weeks, my youngest was 3, and I kind of thought to myself, that's a wild long time to be away from home. So I said, look, I would go on the proviso that they would let me come home at the weekends. So they went away and deliberated on it and came back and said, okay, we'll fly you out on a Monday and fly you home on a Friday. So I did that for 4 weeks. So I flew business class. I was picked up in a car that had a chauffeur with the air conditioning. I was driven away up into the mountains to a place called Meknes, where we had a house that had ensuite bathrooms for all the bedrooms. Mm. And we had a cook that cooked. And the chauffeur came in the morning and picked us up and took us to the factory. And we were looked upon as if we were lords and ladies. You know, we really were. I got so many marriage proposals from men those 4 weeks, because the poor critters, it was the only way they could get out of the contract. And they didn't care if I was married to somebody else, like, because they just wanted to get out. But while we were driving to the factories in the morning, I could see women coming out of hedges and going to the factories to work. And I turned to the lady who was along with me and I said, you know, there, for the grace of God, go you and me, because we are factory girls. They are factory girls, but they just happen to be born in Morocco and we happen to be born in Derry. But there's no difference between them and us. You know, and it was an eye-opener for me, because we think we have it bad, but you know, it was really, really tough. But I will say, whenever I was there, I never saw any evidence of underage employment. And another fact that I don't know if any of you have ever worked in Springtown factory or worked in New Buildings factories, but whenever you go into a shirt factory or a jeans factory, all you hear is the noise of machines. You know, whenever I went into the factories in Morocco, the noise that I heard was a woman chatting. So the stuff is being made out there for little or nothing, but the women back here were on time and study, and they never lifted their head. So you know, there was differences as well. You know, so that just so it always made me think about how lucky we are to be born here, and not there, because your life would have been so different.
My husband was in Morocco the same thing as you. Mm-hmm. He managed the day to battle Lamadari, which was Mark's work, and he was sent out there at the time, and that'll tell you, it was to stay, say, 2 weeks and show them what he do and all, and they did offer him an awful amount of money to go out and live in it. But he came home before the 2 weeks was up, and I opened the door and I thought you had to stay in Morocco. Couldn't stick it.
Yeah.
He couldn't stick it, he came home, but they closed the dainty fat anyway. But Lewis just couldn't stick it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he says he couldn't put up with it.
Mm.
He says, that's a disgrace.
Totally, in all fairness.
And he was on about them liberals and all, you see, mm-hmm. he would have been all into that, because he says, they're still saying made in Britain, and you can buy them in Marks and all,
mm-hmm.
and they're not made there at all, they're made out there for half nothing.
Yeah.
I suppose within this, this little story, I think, is what I see, Catherine, is I see your humanity. You know, you just said we're lucky, you know, we're lucky that we have, look at the, in a sense, look at the luxury we have here in this very room with cameras and sofas, leather seats and a lunch and so on.
And fresh water.
Yeah. So I see your humanity in this story. I can see your concern for other people. I can see your wishing to connect, which seems to be to the heart and core of Foyle Women's Information Network. It's not just, in my perception, a network where information is exchanged, though that's vital.
Yeah.
It seems to be that conversation, crack, insight, learning, connection are established. And also a great desire that women will take their role in the on the political world as well.
Right.
I take leadership roles.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're about...
Yeah,
about 2 o'clock, is it?
Yes.
Yeah. So, give Catherine Cooke a very good round of applause.
Thank you.
Lovely.
You have a new career there, if it ever all goes
belly up.